So let's get started here. First up is Smitty's piano. Now this piano is the sound that Michael W. Smith has used for, gosh, easily the last 25 years. So let's go noodle around here and let's see what happens. Cider on that. I'll show you what happens. It gets a little bit brighter. Just cuts through a little bit more, as if this piano's not bright enough already. It's super bright, but what's cool about that is it really, really cuts through in a live mix in a way that I've never heard with any other piano. So it's got a big, huge low end and a real, you know, piercing top end, which is not bad necessarily. Take the exciter off. Now let's add a little bit of hall to that. That's the idea. Maybe a little dream. Gives you that Strymon Big Sky reverb effect. Turn that off. Little delay. Oops, meant to turn that off. Of course, you can tap your tempo in. One, two, three, four. Okay, so moving on to Blair Masters Grand. Cider on that. See, so even though it's a milder piano, you can still get it to cut through a little bit. Just add some of that exciter and gives you a little bit more definition. Now, cool thing about Blair's piano, it takes really well to the dream verb thing. So if you want to really make it atmospheric, it's great for contemplative moments and that kind of stuff. So you get the idea. And on all the pianos, I put just a little bit of room reverb on them. It just gives them a little bit of realism. You know, I find that with really dry piano samples, it makes them sound fake, because when you're listening to a real piano, you're usually in a room. You're always in a room. But, you know, you want it to have a little bit of space around it. That helps sell the illusion. Okay, so that's Blair's piano. Now, the Steinway and Yamaha, those are just main stages, factory samples that I added some EQ and compression to just to kind of make them pop a little bit. So, part of it again is that room. I actually really like the Steinway. It's a pretty good sample for being included in a $30 program. And again, you add some exciter to it. So the difference between the two reverbs, the hall reverb is what it sounds like. It's just a hall that happens to be a really nice one. Dream is emulating the very popular Strymon Big Sky pedal, which is huge right now, especially in modern worship circles. It's a modulated reverb, so it's got a lot of chorus on the back of it. And it, of course, it rings forever. And it's really cool. You can kind of create pads out of just about anything. But it's not very realistic. So when you want just a regular, beautiful sounding hall, you want to use the regular hall send. Of course, you can dial in as much as you want. Okay, onto the Yamaha. Not a big fan of this piano, honestly. It's it doesn't sound as wide as the others in terms of the stereo field. But if you're playing in a mono PA system, this one actually is probably a better choice because it's not going to have any phase issues. So, and it's not bad. It's not a bad piano. What I would do is use this slot in Backstage Pass to put a favorite of yours in there, something like Alicia's Keys or Grandeur or whatever piano you might like. Just put it, you can put it in this slot where the Yamaha is. And of course, you can do that anywhere else as well. Okay, moving on. Dreamy Roads. By default, it's a very atmospheric. You can see that both the exciter and the dream and reverb and delay are on this guy. Not something you want to play fast songs on, but for atmospheric stuff. Of course, you can always turn that stuff off. So by default, it's just a regular old Rhodes with a little bit of grit on it. But you can see that dream effect really creates almost a pad out of anything. like delay too. I like a stereo delay. Of course, you're not going to want that on a lot of things, but there you go. Dirty Roads is what it sounds like. It's just a real gnarly, overdriven road sound, which is great for certain things. So that's Dirty Roads. Okay, MKS-20 Roads, this was the sound of CCM music in the 90s. Also used a lot in gospel circles and in pop. My gosh. Chicago. David Foster used this sound all the time. Let's see, a little Chicago here. And Lest We Not Forget. The thing I love about the MKS-20 has this huge bottom end to it. Okay, Smitty's B3. I'm going to cover this in a whole separate video dedicated to this because there's a lot to it. But just so you can get a feel for it, I'll just give you a quick tour. Okay, now what you're hearing is not my preferred sound quite yet. You'll notice that the Leslie room mic slider is almost all the way off. And that is the downfall of so many Hammond emulations. You want some air around the Leslie. Right now it's really dry and in your face. So let's add some room mics. Now all of a sudden it sounds like you've got a proper Leslie cabinet that's mic'd and you're listening back in the room. It just gives the Leslie a little space to move. So that's one thing. So let's add a little drive. Okay, pull that back down. Let's see, you want some percussion? And of course, haven't really even done anything with drawbars yet. I don't like doing drawbars on an iPad because they're not tactile. But if you don't happen to have a real drawbar controller, it'll definitely get you through. So, let's see what we got here. And you can do multi-touch. You can do more than one at a time. And let's turn a little vibrato on. Not a huge fan of vibrato either, actually. I'm much more of a rock B3 guy, so but the option is there. You also have key click controls, key click down and on the upstroke. So hear what that's doing. So really way too much for my taste. But the point is, this is your B3. So you can make it do whatever you want and however you want. another thing, you can use the mod wheel to change Leslie's speed. Or it will respond to sustain pedal too. It'll toggle back and forth, so you can play with both hands. Okay, so we'll do another video dedicated to the B3. Moving on, Notre Dame. This is just a big old pipe organ. That, when you move the mod wheel, brings in brighter stops. So that's pipe organ. Moving on, the big string program. Now this guy, again, if you saw the teaser, this responds to both controller 11 on one pedal, and if you've got a control that has two pedal inputs, you can use the other one and assign it to the mod wheel, which lets you play with both hands, which is really crucial for this particular sound. So what happens is, with both pedals down, you get nothing. The expression pedal brings in dynamics overall, or expression, excuse me. The other pedal adds some extra violin and viola on one side, on the left side a little bit in the stereo field where they would be, and with more vibrato intensity. So it lets you dig in on more passionate or expressive sections. So here's what happens. Now, what if you don't have two expression pedals? Unfortunately, you have to use your left hand and control the mod wheel, which does the same thing as the foot pedal. So it's kind of no way around that, but at least you have the option. So there you go. That's the big string program. The issue is with this thing, this is the only solution I know of that's really designed to cater to live playing, which really lets you sound like a real string section. I mean, as close as possible, obviously. You're never going to sound exactly like the real thing. It's just not possible. But you can certainly be more expressive with this patch than you can with a keyboard or, you know, any commercial sample library that's designed for scoring. And notice the CPU meter, it's barely at 0.25%. So even though it's using three massive layers, it's very light on the CPU, which you could never do with a big string library that's dedicated to strings. Okay, so strings and Tron. This one is more of an affected, kind of a fake. It's got a Mellotron layer in there with strings, and this one is designed for, I'm trying to think of an example of a song. There's a Hillsong tune, and I forget what it's called now, but it starts with a string intro. Goes something like this. So the idea with this sound is not to sound real. It's to sound textural and like a modern affected kind of thing. So it's got a much faster attack as well, so you can hit it a little harder. Strings TBA, that's an empty patch right now. In a future expansion, that's going to be some faster articulations like staccato and stuff like that. All right, moving on. Simple Warmth. This sound is just a very simple, warm analog pad that I sampled in the mid-90s from a combination of a Korg Wave Station and a Roland JV-1080. And so actually it's not an analog pad, but it's supposed to sound like an analog pad. But this sound I have used on every live Michael W. Smith album since 2001. And so it's been heard quite a bit. And I'll tell you, this sound really glues together a live band situation like nothing else. It's awesome behind a piano, and I'll show you in another video and in the manual how to create quick splits and layers and stuff like that. It's very easy, but this is really cool for just backing another instrument. And every pad sound, or almost every pad sound in the whole library, uses mod wheel to control filter. So you can, by default, it's open. So it's going to be its brightest setting almost in every patch. But if you increase the mod wheel, kind of closes the filter a little bit and gives you a darker sound. So that's Simple Warmth. I'll lead you home, start getting into some more textural pads. Now, there's a ton of reverb on that. So what if you don't want that much? All the pads are sent to a special bus just for the pads, and you can control that down here. So let's turn that. These knobs aren't synchronized yet to that, but that's actually, that patch still has a bunch of decay, but okay, here's just another one. Okay, this next patch is Leviathan. This patch was originally created from several analog synths, an Alesis Andromeda, a Jupiter 8, I'm trying to remember this. It goes back a long time, but I've used this sound as well in every Michael W. Smith concert for the last 20 years, and all the worship records and so on. There's a song he does called Agnus Dei, and it's usually at the end of the night. And man, the thing about this sound, when you have subwoofers or a large PA system, this sound has literally shaken countless arenas and stadiums around the world. And the cool thing about it is as with many of the other pads, the mod wheel opens up the filter and it just is massive. It just is massive. I wish you could hear it in my studio here. I've got these PMC mastering monitors, which are ridiculous, and it is bigger than should be legal. But anyway, moving on. This next patch, Lead Me On to the 80s. Anybody that's ever listened to vintage CCM, late 80s, Amy Grant came out with a record called Lead Me On, and this patch is a recreation of several layered synths that make the filter close down here a little bit. It's Basically, it's Smitty's piano run through a filter and then these synth layers. Now, this is one of four combo patches. If you look on the iPad display, there are four of them down here. This is number two, that's number one, this is one we're on now. And these four slots are designed for you to create your own custom layered sounds. If you want to do any split stuff, you could do an arpeggiator on one side of the keyboard, whatever you want. That's how I set these four programs up. There's also a sound in here that it's called Secret Ambition, and that's from the song by that name. And it's just kind of a real mellow analog pad that gets brighter with filter, but that's what this is. Okay, so that's that. Let's see what Eddie Van Oberheim is here. You can tell I'm a fan of the 80s. So that's that one. Layers upon layers, this is just an example of taking any of the pad sounds in Backstage Pass and layering them. Let's go over to our other control page here. You see these layered sections here, sliders. By default, now you'll notice they're gonna change. When I change patches, they're gonna change to reflect what the patch settings are. So in this case, let's bring up layer two and see what happens. Now layer three. Can't remember if I put anything on four or not at the moment, but. And again, then you have mod wheel on top of it, which gives you filter control. So just with those three controls, you can sculpt all kinds of possibilities with those controls. So that's a great example of what you can do, just layering three or four patches that are all very different from each other and combining them with your layer controls here. And oh, by the way, over here, every preset that you scroll through, every patch might have more than one layer. So in these combo patch cases, they do. That's why these faders over here are changing. So when you go to this sound layers upon layers, this first volume control over here, that's always going to control your main patch volume. So say if you go back to MKS-20 Rhodes, that's not a layer, that's just a single sound. So that gives you volume control of just that sound. When you go to one of the layers though, or one of the combos, that controls your first layer, and then layers 2, 3, 4, and 5 are over here. Okay, next one. For the Star Wars fans, this is, as it sounds like. That's my best attempt at Kylo Ren's lightsaber. So put on your nerd hat and again, if you got subwoofers, this will melt faces. But it's also got layers. So down here is your lightsaber, up here, it's an atmospheric textural thing from a Korg wave station. Then you come up here. So lots of fun can be had with just that one patch. All right, next we get into three examples of arpeggiated synth. Now, you hear there's some reverb on that, a little bit of ambience. So if you go to page one on the iPad, down here, and also in the lower left corner of the on-screen controls, it's called ARP Ambience. That's without any on, it's going to be real dry. So that's where you control that. So moving on. So now say you don't want the ARP ambience. Let's get rid of that. You still hear that there's some effects on there. So let's go back to the channel layer. There is a delay. That's a ping pong delay. So that gives you a nice wide delay. And of course you can add any other effects. So there you go. Now I like a little bit of that arpeggio ambience. So just gives you a nice little bit of atmosphere there. All right, moving on. There are some lo-fi versions of the pianos, if you want that kind of thing. It works great for layers where you're adding some synth stuff. So that's that. Steinway. Now this one, the dream verb is on. Can be kind of cool with the lo-fi thing. Two different versions of Blair Masters piano. This one's real verbed out, kind of dark. Another one with the Yamaha. You get the idea. Okay, moving on. MKS-20 Gospel. This is real bright. Digital piano sound from the early 90s. Elton John used it a ton. Lots of people use it, but it's huge in gospel music. In fact, Michael Jackson on the Dangerous record, there's a song called Keep the Faith. Let's see if I can remember it. So it's real percussive, really cool sound for certain things. Dream Valley Road, this is just a Rhodes through a lot of reverb. Again, kind of cool for textural moments. Get the idea. Down to organs, these are just the separated layers from the big pipe organ program above. Okay, now, my favorite category, pads. There are about 40, give or take, pads from all different kinds of sources, and they all sound really different, so there's lots of options here. Cool thing about these is you can combine them, like I was showing you above, into the combination patches, and really create some cool stuff. So I'm just going to stop talking and cycle through these. Thank you. All right, I got to tell you about this sound. This is from a Korg Wave Station, and when you play at softer velocities, it'll play in a minor key. Hit it harder. Major. So you can kind of do some cool stuff with this. Now again, you're going to notice As you've listened to these, they're drenched in that dream reverb, which you can dial back simply for all the pads. They all go to the pads bus. You can dial it down right here. Same with delay. So if you find one that has a little bit more of an attack to it, let's see here. It doesn't have an attack, but it's clearer, so you can tell. Dial up the delay and see what happens. So just doing that in a live setting gives you the space of reverb without the muddiness of notes overlapping and getting in the way. So using the delay can be a real cool trick, especially if you're in a really big room. So that's pads. Strings, I won't go through those again. Those are just the separate versions of the string, or excuse me, separate layers of the string combo patch. You can play with those. Tron Nostalgia is the Mellotron isolated patch. So, and then just for fun, I gave you a couple synth sounds to play with. These are all in the combo sounds above, just kind of layered. But there's a lot more of those to come in future versions. These accent synths, there's just four of these for now. I'm going to add more of these later. These sounds are kind of cool, layered with a piano and pad. Okay, so that's those. And now we will move on to the last section of patches. These are the arpeggiated synth sounds. Just a few flavors here. Now again, got the ARP ambience control here. Now some of these sounds have some reverb built into them, so that's what you're hearing on this one. But the ambience control for arpeggiated patches will still give you more or less. Now, of course, you can also, per patch, dial in more reverb or delay. And again, tap tempo control. 1, 2, 3, 4. You course, you can also dial in your tempo if you know what it is. You can get wherever you want to go. Just a handful of the arpeggiated sounds, and again, that's just part of volume one. One of the expansion packs I've got planned is a whole bunch of more of that kind of stuff. So anyway, that is a walkthrough of the basic patches. One of the teaser videos went into atmosphere a little bit, but I'll show you that again. Let me first pull up Blair's piano here, and got some verb on it. Let me make something real dreamy. And let's say, let's stay in the key of C. You want to turn it on, turn on atmosphere, then pick a key. Of course, you got your level control right here. And it's pre-effect, so you're never going to get a nasty, abrupt volume change when you play with these sliders. Let's say you want to take atmosphere up an octave. So you hit your up octave button. Next time you hit a key, let's go back down an octave. Now, when you bring the filter up, and then turn it off. Just fades nicely into the background. So there you go. That's just a general overview. There's a lot more to show you here when we get into the iPad stuff in a separate video. You have attack, decay, sustain, and release, basic envelope controls for certain sounds. They're not mapped in every sound because it doesn't apply to every sound. You're not going to want to change that on a piano, for example. Anyway, that's a general layout. Just so you know, this middle layer, for those of you who already have Backstage Pass, this is not mapped yet either. I'm creating this as a controller to actually run main stage in edit mode. So rather than have to mess around with your mouse and key commands, you can just do it all right here. So that's coming in a future free update as well. So there you go. All right. Hope you enjoy Backstage Pass. Meet you all the way.